Glad you could join us this evening. I'm Hugh Hefner, editor-publisher of Playboy magazine, and your host. And this is Playboy's Penthouse. Come on in and meet some of our guests. Well, here we have Eleanor Bradley and Miss Joyce Nazari, two of our most popular playmates, and Lenny Bruce, foremost exponent of sick humor and...
Oh! Isn't that sick? Yeah. Oh, boy, the champagne is really making my nose bubbly, Uncle Hugh.
Especially well-known for his extemporaneous and ad-lib jokes.
That was ad-lib, you like that?
That was very ad-lib. Over here we've got our own A.C. Spektorsky, associate publisher of Playboy and author of The Exurbanites. Back here, Cy Coleman, fellow of the Root Witchcraft, and a number of other very famous tunes, and Charlie Shavers, Man with a Trumpet. And Cy also wrote the tune you heard at the beginning of this show, our theme, and we're pretty excited about it, Cy.
Well, so am I, actually, and so are the boys. It was really one of the most exciting dates I'd ever been at. I've never seen quite so many musicians ensemble for a little trio like that. There were 39 in all, I guess.
Mm-hmm, 39 or 40 men, and Cy wrote the tune for us just this past 2 weeks on a special assignment. We got together a good bit of the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, I think, along with everybody else.
Yes, like I say, there were violinists there that didn't see each other in years. They shook hands on the date. They said, "Where have you been?"
We think we may have a hit record, and we're going to try and release it as a commercial record.
Well, that's very exciting. I think it's a good record. I think it's a good musical record. It's something we're all proud of.
Well, yeah. We're happy about it.
I'm really excited.
You're working on a new Broadway show, too, aren't you?
Well, that's right. I'm working on a show called Skyscraper for Fuhr and Martin. Mm-hmm. They're the fellows that did Guys and Dolls, Silk Stockings, and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And what it is, it's a show about contemporary New York. You know, it's, if you notice New York today, it looks like it's been bombed out.
You know, everything's being rebuilt.
Yeah, thanks.
What are you drinking?
I'm all set, Lenny.
Thank you.
Well, it really looks like, you know, with all these new buildings going up and everything, you know, that's the recent thing with Toots Shaw when he refused to sell for quite a while?
I didn't know about that.
That's right. He was the last holdout on the block, and they were putting up the new Zeckendorf Hotel there. Ah. So what we have is we have a little brownstone, and we have a little old lady that lives in this brownstone that won't sell to the big mighty skyscraper going up, and this is our whole story, and we have a romance, and it really is a very exciting project.
And this is set to open when?
Well, I can't tell you when it's going to open. We have a tentative rehearsal date set for August.
I see. So maybe next fall.
That's right.
That's right. Very exciting. Now, the song you're most famous for, of course, is Witchcraft that Frank recorded here a couple of years ago.
Yes, yes, that's a biggie.
I understand, we were talking earlier, there's a part of this tune you said that you wrote after the record was made?
That's right. As a matter of fact, you know, it just goes to show you that you really never stop writing. You never stop writing a song. When Frank made the record and it became a little bit of a hit, we said, you know, it felt like it needed a little bit more, maybe just a little verse or something. So we sat down, Carolyn Lee, by the way, who did the lyrics on Witchcraft, and I sat down and we wrote a little, we call it an interlude. It can be used as a verse. Mm-hmm. And we just put it on. Frank never heard this interlude because the record was already released.
And I haven't either.
Yeah, well, some people do it that have heard it, but it's something completely new to the song. Would you like to hear it?
I'd like to very much.
Mm-hmm. All right, Witchcraft. Fingers in my hair, that's like come hear the stare that strips my conscience bare. It's witchcraft, and I've got no defense for it, 'cause the heat is too intense for it. What good would common sense for it do? 'Cause it's witchcraft, wicked witchcraft, and although I know it's strictly taboo, when you arouse the need in me, my heart says yes indeed, and me proves proceed with what you're leading me to. 'Cause it's such an ancient pitch, and it's one that I'd never switch. 'Cause there's no nicer witch than you. Now here's the part. Shades of old Lucretia Borgia, there's the devil in you tonight. And although my heart adores you, my head says it ain't right. Right to let you make advances, oh no. Under normal circumstances I'd go, but oh, when you arouse the need in me, my heart says yes indeed in me. Proceed with what you're leading me to, 'cause it's such an ancient pitch, and it's one that I'd never switch. 'Cause there's no nicer witch than you. My heart says yes indeed in me. Come on, arouse that need in me. 'Cause there's no nicer witch than you.
I just found out, Si, that you wrote a song that's a special favorite with me, Don't Try to Change Me Now, which Frank included in his latest album.
That's right. That's one of the first songs I wrote. I've written many songs, but it's one of the first, mm-hmm. And it's the one that has the fondest memories for me, so I'm glad you like that one, because it's close to me.
You do very many things that Frank records.
Well, as a matter of fact, I've got a new song coming out that Sinatra's doing. It's called The Best Is Yet to Come. It's a funny thing, standing right over here, Charlie Shavers, just as I was going to do the demo record, but we make demo records, and mm-hmm. I sing it and we send it out to the artist, mm-hmm. Whoever it is. And we happened to send this particular demo record to Frank, and I was walking along the street just before we made it, Charlie Shavers was walking down. I said, Charlie, would you come up and help me on this thing? And Charlie said, sure, and he came up and we made the demo and Frank accepted it.
That's crazy. Now, this is something that has not yet been recorded.
Well, it hasn't even been heard around, as a matter of fact. He hasn't recorded it yet, but he intends to record it.
Charlie's here and you're here. Maybe we could get you to play it for us and give the people a chance to hear it.
Well, I don't see why not. Okay.
Wait till you're locked in my embrace. make it here. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? The best is yet to come, come the day you're mine.
Oh, you got Lenny's album there.
We're special fans of Lenny's.
Are you? This is a wild cover with a picnic in the middle of a graveyard.
Watermelon and all.
These two young ladies are a couple of our most popular playmates. Joyce was a playmate in December, and Eleanor in February.
Right.
And Joyce, actually, from the mail that we got, was the most popular playmate of last year, and we think that if everything works, well, if the letters keep coming in like they have been, I think Eleanor's going to wind up the most popular of this year. Now, Joyce's home is in Miami, which is where we originally found her. And Eleanor, you originally were from?
Waukegan, Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
Very small.
But we didn't find you there.
No. Actually, what happened, I was out in California on vacation. And the photographer spotted me and took some test shots, which was sent into the magazine. And then approximately, about 3 months later, there it was in the February issue.
Mm-hmm. After that, we didn't miss the chance, and we got her on into the magazine, and she now works at the Playboy building as a receptionist.
Well, actually, I do a little bit more than reception work right now. I've been doing quite a bit of promotion work for the magazine. I've been in approximately 19 cities from New York to California, talking to advertising clubs and junior chamber of commerce groups. And I was also honored with the title of Miss Marine Air Reserve.
Mm-hmm. Very recently.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
uh-huh. Well, we like to feel that becoming a playmate is sort of just the beginning for the girls. With the popularity of the magazine and the popularity of the pinup feature, it often leads to show business, if that's what the girls are interested in, or things in TV and movies.
Even chances to meet Frank Sinatra.
That's right, which you did and got a part in his...
A
small part in Hole in the Head. And had a pretty good time in the picture, and I understand you kind of dug Frank and he dug you.
Oh, but I love Playboy best.
I think we'll stop overhead. Listen, there's something here that I want you kids to see. This is kind of special.
Thank you.
This is a special little gadget that we did a feature on here about, about 2 issues ago, I think it was, Speck. And it's Speck's baby. He's an author and editor, but in this case, he turned out to be a designer.
What is it?
Well, it looks like a hi-fi, but actually what it does is replace the kitchen. So we called it, logically enough, the kitchenless kitchen. You can actually cook on this thing, keep your food in it, the whole scene. Why don't we open it up and show them how it works. Get it back here.
For heaven's sake.
Wow.
Now this opens up and serves as a bar, and the chairs, of course, are here, so you can eat right off of this. And then your preparatory area is here with all manner of gadgets, etc.
Where do you cook?
Well, now here's the thing. For instance, if you want waffles, you have a waffle iron which has its own heating element. You just plug it into this continuous plug strip. And if you spoil a waffle, you dump it in here, which has
down
the disposal.
This whole thing, you see, is actually, it has no stove, either gas or electric. Each one of the individual items that we use, all the accessories,
maybe
we can pick some of them up. These accessories are all actually stoves in themselves, or each one of them does its individual function.
Slide out shelf here, for instance, suppose you wanted a bean pot or something. You see, you have a heating element here, and you're plug in the thing here, and you just plug it in, put your prepared food in there, which you find, by the way, in the refrigerator, which is right here. See, it has its own fridge.
It's actually a complete kitchen in one unit.
Electric coffee maker.
Show them this thing that makes the steaks.
I want to show them this. This is a deep fat fryer. You know how good French fries are? You see, it has its own basket, which hangs up.
There's actually no limit to, you see, you just keep buying gadgets.
All these
for
gadgets.
You. Once you have the basic element, you keep bringing the individual gadgets in, and everything plugs in here.
speaking.
Hi, hi. Wonderful, wonderful. All right, I'll see you in a little bit. Very good. Kids, that was Ella Fitzgerald. She's going to be with us a little later this evening.
Oh, great. Isn't that wonderful? Pep, why don't you go ahead and take care of your guests, and I'll help the girls wrestle up some.
Okay, good.
Come and get me some tea.
Hey, hey,
that's that circulating. Hey, say what's happening. You know? Give me a taste.
Yeah. Huh? You having a good time?
Yeah, it's good. I'm beat there.
That's it?
Yeah. I was kind of rude with those. I was talking to the chicks, and then all of a sudden they sort of floated up into.
I wonder if I can have a drink.
This is a kind of an interesting party. You know, I first figured it would be like sort of a TV, you know,
you.
Typical fake party, you know. But it's got a good party feeling to it, with some pretty chicks, you know, which is a good composite here.
Well, the girls, and we and serve drink. Real liquor, and it does the trick.
You think you'll get any objection, you know, drinking on the show? I don't think I've ever seen that on the show. Do you think that'll be objection?
We'll find out. We hope not.
Yeah, I hope not. Because I would hope so if none of the viewers drank at home. But if they do drink, then I would want the same honesty to be on the show, you know, which should be the motivation for the show. And then that's what grooved me about the show, that it's an honest, it's actually a party. So whatever happens at a party, within, you know, limitations.
Well, we're trying to, trying to build the personality of the show out of the magazine itself and make the thing a sort of a sophisticated weekly get-together of the people that we dig and who dig us. Just have ourselves a kind of a late night ball.
When I first heard that Playboy was going to do a penthouse party, I sort of wondered, and you know, not what you're supposing. I wondered, you know, because I would never satirize the obvious. I wondered about the sponsor, because I'm sure that, you know, there has to be some sponsor identification. And I was wondering about the sponsor. Will the sponsor out there say, well, Playboy is very chic and, as you said, sophisticated. The magazine is filled with car coats, sports cars, and this is a prospective sponsor out there. Do you figure that your viewer, suppose he can't afford the sports car, the sports coat? Well, I've been thinking about that. And I'm glad that you've got some guts. You're not interested in the people that don't have any money.
That's right.
I mean, you people out there, this is just my opinion, you people out there are just going to have to wait till your own magazine comes along, the Reader's Digest, maybe, you know.
They'll have their own TV show.
Yeah, or Field and Stream. That'd be good. Field and Stream, the playmate for December, has a duck in her mouth. And she comes out with me, sort of a group. Let's see the magazine. Let's see. This is the October one.
With Eleanor on the cover.
Yeah, well, no, let me get a later one. Let me get a later Playboy. Okay. The things I remember most about, you know, the letters to the editor, I can always say, let's have some more of Linda Johnson. Those kind of nuts who write in, you know. And that's always Linda Johnson writing in.
Or her mother, right?
Yeah, Ralph Johnson. And then they had the things on the beatniks and that kind of, you know, that which is magazine writing today.
I imagine we're going to probably have a program dedicated to beat one of these days soon with Kerouac and.
There's a funny thing, the beatnik.
Mm-hmm.
I went by a a coffee shop thing. So there's a guy with a beard there, you know, and I used to speak strictly in the hip idiom. So the guy's got the beard, and I figure I'll relax him, I'll talk hip. So I was like, what's shaking, baby? And he started talking Jewish. He was a rabbi. Which is like pretty.
Can't tell some of this.
Yes, Beck, that's good, good.
Can't tell with beards these days.
Before, you know, I admire the Spectrosky very much, and I like you. And I thought later, when we were talking early with Nat Cole, that I seemed a little hostile. I wasn't. I didn't want that to come across. But sometimes, if I'm very exuberant, you know, and I'll yell, you know, and then it sounds like sort of rank, you know. So if I seem that way, I want to apologize to you.
This is pretty different than than the TV shows you're used to doing, the Steve Allen things and the spectacular, a little more relaxed and a little more fun. What kind of, you work areas of humor that are controversial and, according to some people, pretty sick. Do you consider yourself a sick comic?
Yeah, that's interesting. Do I consider myself sick? No. There's a way, sick, let's take the word, you know, semantics, you know. There's no such thing, naturally, as sick comedy, you know. There's no such thing as beatniks. It's a writer's device. Beatniks were back as in Maxwell Bodenheim's era in the village. Sick jokes go as far back as Shakespeare. But it's, do you have a Kleenex or something? Have you got, one of the chicks got a Kleenex? Yeah? I never carry a handkerchief. Isn't that strange? I don't even have a, do you have one? Good. I never do carry a handkerchief. I'm gonna tell you something I've never told anybody before. I've never blown my nose before.
The first time.
All right, they say, this is a TV first.
Television first.
Mm-hmm. Should I just do it on camera?
I'm sure you've never blown your nose on camera before. I think it's allowed.
All right, I mean,
it's a casual show, and
it's what does the code say? Just let it go,
I think so.
Am I in a close shot? I'd like to.
We'll bring
okay.
In a close up and bring up the sound.
Here it goes. I can't. All right, I'll just turn around. You get the feel. I hate you.
Give me back my hand.
No, I'm really gonna do it. I'm not putting you on. All right, here it goes. Where did you get this? Is this a rug swatch?
That's.
Right, next thing.
I'm gonna dress my
way.
Oh.
No.
What?
This is. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Now, maybe there's. See, that's how. That could start to be a whole new vogue for comedy, you know. Or I may. This may be my thing on television. You see the guy that blew his nose on Penthouse Party? And I got on the Jack Parr show. Mm-hmm. And then it could just start to build, you know. I could do interviews and that, and then they could label it like sick comedy. You know, the guy say, well, when did you first start blowing your nose on television? Well, it was just one time. I was with Hugh Hefner and Inspector Oski, and I sniffled, and the guy said, want to use my handkerchief? And it just happened. It was a meeting of the minds, sort of. And I just blew my nose, and then I became controversial. Just going around, and you can just do it once a night, though.
What's it like doing a show like, Steve Allen's or any of the big network shows? Is it,
You can't blow your nose.
That's one of the
No, there are some restrictions. No. You
right.
Can't
imagine.
Did Steve ever let you con him out of a handkerchief? I mean, I noticed that. Rewrote history.
That's
there
the old
a little.
Trick.
You said, I offered you the handkerchief.
Yeah,
remember?
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Well, I'll never get it back.
There were some restrictions, but not from Steve Allen. Do you know Steve Allen's been trusted? I think you'll agree, maybe, that I feel he is the most literate. He is perhaps the most erudite, humane humorist on the American scene today. Besides comedy, he's interested, and I'm not being facetious now, Strontium 90, Fallout. Does he ever send you any of that kind of literature? He's very active, you know, with the Albert Schweitzer mm-hmm. kind of thing, and I really like him. But he doesn't control the whole show. Profit motivation and sponsors do. So, when I did the first show, you know, they had, they're naturally afraid of the way I work, you know, and it's a live show, it's not taped, so I could have, you know, been pretty irreverent. So they had me audition, which is very hard for me. I do pretty spontaneous humor, and to do word-for-word comedy is just horrendous. So I did a joke, and Steve is cracking up. He's laughing. But the producer, Bill Harbach, you know, he's laughing, but he's got a little more to lose. Like, ha ha ha. So I did a joke on the show. Oh, yeah. I made reference to a joke I used to do, and I said that I have a tattoo, you know, which I actually had. Mm-hmm. And I got this in Malta, in the Mediterranean, about 1942. And I said that, in the joke I did on the show, I said I smoked Marlboros when I was 6 years old and it grew up. Yeah. Which is like a funny joke. Okay, now, then I went into a truism. And I said, because of this tattoo, I never can be buried in a Jewish cemetery. That's the truth. That's the Orthodox scene. You have to go out of the world the way you came in, with no marks or no changes here. So when I got back from Malta, I was over at my aunt's house in Jamaica, Long Island, and she's very orthodox. So I'm in her kitchen, I'm washing with the Roki soap there, you know. So she pins the tattoo and she flips, you know. She goes, ah! It's a real Jewish minor bird. Yeah. I said, you learn your arm. You can be buried in a Jewish cemetery. I said, what do you nudge me for? Maybe they'll cut the sword, they'll bury this in a Gentile cemetery. You know? And leave me alone. Okay, which is like cute and humorous. Okay, now, continuity says to me, you can't do that. You can't, so why not? He said, well, it's definitely offensive to the Jewish people. I said, you're a nut. He said, no, it is blah, 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 blah. He said, any time we do any humor on any ethnic groups, you know, there's a lot of mail. Now, let me first set that straight. I think that anybody who writes in to anybody are whacks. Nuts. Any of you people out of your skull out there who sit in and write stations, you know. Because I know anyone who's got a function, married women with children are too busy, you know, guys who work. So it has to be some... complete far-out wacko who's sitting alone in a furnished room, you know, with a TV set the Goodwill gave him, you know, and he's saying, ah, that's dirty! You know, and meanwhile he's choking pigeons and a good craft ebbing background, you know. Oh, I got off on a tangent. Well, anyway, so the guy said to me, can't do the joke. I said, well, later, I'm not going to do the show, you know, because I've got enough bread, I don't have to make this scene, you know. So he says to me, nah, blah, 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 blah. You see, you don't need that. I said, look, it's not offensive to the Jewish people. I'm Jewish and it doesn't offend me and I represent. I'm the Messiah, okay? So I said, nah. Okay, now, dig, they have a whole hassle, you know. So the guy goes back and there's about 20 guys. They all get together and they talk it over. And the guy comes back and he says, Lenny, we talked it all over and it's definitely offensive to the Gentile people too. I said, how do you figure that? He said, well, what you're saying in essence is that the Gentiles don't care what they bury. So, you know, go fight that kind of thing.
Oh, too much. Well, we hope we'll have no such problems with our show here. We're going to...
No, it's getting better, you know. Mm-hmm.
I see. Yeah, I think you're right. I sense a change in the times and an ability to discuss things more openly on TV and movies,
I think we're going
magazines.
Through a... A very interesting transition. First, there was Burl, slapstick, you know, out comedy. Just a moment for sick comedy, by the way. As I said, there was nothing new. Time magazine grouped about four or five sick comics. Let's negate that immediately. Mortsall, brilliant, political, stand-up, stark monologist. Nothing sick about him, or he would have never done a Revlon spec. Shelley Berman, real Hamish, down-home humor, forget him. Jonathan Winters. Yeah, Jonathan's he's beautiful. He's a little sick. Yeah, I dig him. In fact, they're taking me away soon. Jonathan Finked on me. That's how he got out. He turned into nuts. And that's what the guy said. If I turn in four nuts, I can stay on the street. But Lou Costello, there's a good comedian. Well-liked, well-loved comic. And the era that's criticizing the sick comic today, which, believe me, I feel no hostility towards any reviewer that writes me, because I realize that the reviewer has to take a side, one man's opinion, and for him to knock makes a very interesting column. So I'm not drug with any people who put down sick comedy, you know, because I don't do any sick comedy, you know, but it's a commercial tag that's happened now. It's the same as Calypso, which never was. Let's see, Lou Costello. Let me think of a joke that Costello would do. You'd never think of Lou Costello as a sick comic, would you?
No, family type, home entertainment.
All right, Lou Costello used to do a joke. My wife died last night. Now, I would never move into that area at all in humor. Mm-hmm. I would never. A comedy is tragedy plus time. That's a little too close. Or that's some sicko one. His wife died last night. He's humoring. When she, on her deathbed, she said, when I die, if you cheat on me, I'll dig my way out of my grave and haunt you. which is a pretty macabre situation we're building. The joke, the punchline, I buried her face down, let her dig. That's sick.
Yeah, that's sick.
Very sicko. Well, wife dead crawling through the grave. You know,
Edgar Allan Poe.
Yeah, yeah. The hasty heart.
Well,
know.
It's been suggested, and I think there's something to it, that more than you're really operating in sick areas, it is society itself that maybe has some problems, and you kind of throw a little light on some of them.
Yeah. Then again, I'd like to, you know, I'd love to be the martyr, you know, and say, that's right, a society's sick. And I'm straightening out a lot of societal problems. But I realize that I'm society, you know. It's never they. Your society, you know. And it's like integration to me is a big hang-up. I capsule it very quickly. I don't knock anybody who's not an out-and-out integration. It's just the way I look at it very simply. It's just from a moral aspect. If you're not an out-and-out integrationist, naturally you're an atheist, because Christ and Moses were teachers. And if you keep anybody out of school for 5 minutes, you're against every Christ-like concept, so that you're an atheist. Now, from a safety factor, the missiles, Polaris, Vanguard, Atlas, are made from academic background, physics. You know, there's no such thing as give them a few dollars, they'll fix it. It doesn't work that way. You know. So anyone who is not an out-and-out integrationist is just a communist, pro-communist, you know. So that bugs me. But I never get that. I'm just giving you a build now. I never get that philosophical with it on the floor without getting humorous. Whereas I've watched a lot of nighttime shows where they've got four or five colored people and three or four au fays, and they get heavy with it. It gets too profound. They just start discussing Porgy and Bess, which I'll give you quick for a moment. Porgy and Bess, Otto Preminger, forget him. He's a rank amateur. But as far as Porgy and Bess being a Jim Crow, Uncle Tom picture, not so, because Porgy and Bess, the Spays at that time were funky and down home, you know, and he painted them just that way. Now, if you're going to get on a scene with colored people and not... And if you get too patronizing, then as Ralph Ellison says, it becomes the invisible man. You don't really treat them as people. You know, if, in other words, I'm Jewish, I don't resent Shylock in Shakespeare, you know. So, but on the floor, I'm a bug with integration, so I'll attack it humorously, and I'll go to Little Rock and I'll say that Little Rock has solved the situation. They've done it through legislation. If the colored people can pass the literacy test, they get the vote, and it's very fair.
Well, let's see now. Line all the colored people up here, and if they pass the test, they can get the vote here. It's very easy. Just sign your name. There's this ballpoint pen, this piece of wax paper, and just sign it.
I think it's in the areas of social commentary that you probably come closest to people like Mort and things that Mort does. But you also work with your humor in areas that very few, the little anecdote of Costello's notwithstanding, that very few comics work today. You find humor in some of the strangest and sickest aspects of society, like some kid blowing up his mother in a plane or things of this kind.
Yeah, well, here's how I feel about it. If I start to really analyze my humor, I guess every bit of it stems from some societal problem, or people's concept that I think is hypocrisy. The kid that, remember a couple years ago, kid, and I did on the album too, a kid was stuck in the well?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, there was a child that was trapped in the well. And a doctor attended him, and they got the kid out, and the doctor sent a bill. Right? Now, the nation screamed, you know, what thinks those doctors are, you know? How about that, sending those poor people a bill, you know? Well, naturally, the poor person they sent the bill, let's see, generalize his, maybe as a TV repairman, all right? And he's a poor person opposed to the doctor who maybe grosses $6,000 or $7,000 a month, or a specialist, right? Okay, but how about the poor TV mirror? That schlub wants to get paid now, Daddy, you know. $2 home repair, he wants the bread there, from the doctor, anyone he wants it from. So the doctor naturally has, should get paid. So that struck me sort of humorously and bugged me, too. Mm-hmm. So I satirized it, and I said that they sent the doctor bill, you know, blah, blah, blah. So it brought so much heat on the AMA, the American Medical Association, that all the doctors got together, you know. And the doctor kept saying, I want my money. What do you forget? Look, I want the money, man. I stayed out there with the kid, and it was cold, my legs are chapped, and that's it. I want the bread, that's all. I'm giving, I'll split now. Will you stop it now with that money? Look, I want the money, man, and that's all. I don't want to have no hassle. I sent a bill, $63 plus the medicine, and that's it. I want it. That's all. I want the money. I don't want the guy fixing my TV. I want the money. That's it. Yeah. But you stop with the money. We'll get even next year with a new disease, and that's it. Forget about it. Yeah, we'll swing that way. Get the guys. Give me a new disease for next year. All right, we're thinking. Get the riders up. Give me what disease are you working on? Well, we're thinking of switching the grip. Yeah, we didn't do the grip for a while. That's pretty wild. Yeah, the grip. That's interesting. Let's see. I'll give you a working title for it. Asiatic flu. Okay? Send that out. Call up Park Lilly, get some new pills. The Spaniels died last year. Call up Leonard Solomon, Solomon's Drugs, and get some, I think the greens will go good. And that's it. Okay, doctors, that's it. Asiatic flu. Are there any questions? Yeah, what are the symptoms? Same bit. Nauseous, headache, loss of appetite, all right? All right, what do we tell the people when they want to know where it comes from? Are you kidding? The same bit. It's going around. It's going around. Throw in the body is like a tree, and throw in those other moron parallels, you know, that they understand your body's like an automobile, and if you put the gas on, and those other nitwit things, okay? That's it. I send it out. So that's it. So they got the kid, you know, out of the well, and the report came from Patchogue, New York, that the child is out of the well, the doctor bill will not have to be paid. Of course, the child will have to be returned to the well. That is like, you know, which is sick.
I have a feeling that beneath a little halo on your noble head, there lies a thought or two the devil might be interested to know. Like the finish of a novel that I'll finally have to take to bed. You fascinate me so. I feel like Christopher Columbus when I'm near enough to contemplate the sweet geography descending from your eyebrow to your toe. Possibilities are more than I can possibly enumerate. That's why you fascinate me so. So sermonize and preach to me. Come on and make your sanctimonious little speech to me. But underneath it all, I think that you are really just a reprobate. And you're afraid of what would happen if you ever let it show. You can scold me and berate me, but I'd love to make you hate me. Sanctimonious little speech to me. But oh my darling, you'll forgive my inability to concentrate. I think I'm dealing with a powder keg that's just about to blow. Will the end result deflate me, or will you and
Nat.
Hi.
What a surprise.
How are you?
Great. I'm very pleased you could come up this evening.
Thank you.
Come on in.
Hello. How are you?
Nat, you know,
hi.
Hi.
Hey,
very good.
What's wrong there, you playing?
Thank you. Nat, this is Spec, A.C. Spektorsky, our associate publisher. Just grab a chair here.
Good evening.
Settle down a little bit.
Hey, what's that, baby?
And Nat, I don't know if you know Ronan. This is Rona Jaffe, the author of Best of Everything.
I just bought that book today.
Oh?
Well,
yes.
All the best of everything.
Yes, I haven't gotten into it yet, but I hope to get in.
Nat, do you want a drink?
Yes, I wouldn't mind.
Okay.
A little scotch.
Okay, thank you.
Proceed. I carry my own. Say, Si, I recorded a song a long time ago, a thing called I'm Gonna Laugh You Out of My Life.
He made such a beautiful record of it.
I didn't know this was yours.
Yeah.
That's why.
Wonderful song.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, to sell the record, I think it's just me and I bought them.
I bought one.
You did?
The sale in New York was mine.
I'm wondering how that other one got out.
That's the third copy.
But, you have a new one that you sent to me not so long ago, a thing called Nothing's Changed, which is a beautiful song. In fact, I was talking to Nelson Riddle the other day in Los Angeles about maybe doing that one. If you don't object, of course.
Jacked, or I'm flabbergasted. See, that'll be wonderful.
Si is turning into our favorite composer here. He also wrote the theme for Playboy's Penthouse.
Oh, he did?
Yeah, we recorded that last week.
Well, that's just too much for me, really.
He's a great artist. In fact, he's always been one of my favorite pianists as well as composers. I've never had the chance to tell you, so I'll tell you publicly.
Well, and I'd like to tell you, too, that I saw you at the Chaperie, and it was truly inspirational. That's one of the greatest acts I have ever seen, by none.
And this new thing you're doing, Mr. Cole Will Not Rock and Roll.
That's great. It's one of the greatest satirical numbers I've ever seen.
A wonderful novelty thing. Are you going to, any chance you'll be recording
it? No, I don't think I'll record it, because I think if I record it, it will take the taste off of it. You know, the anticipation, they will know the thing backwards. This way, they don't know they'll have a surprise coming when I do it on the nightclub floor. In fact, you might know the kid that wrote it, Noel Sherman.
Yes, I think I do know him.
He wrote this thing for me quite a few years ago, and I was afraid to do it, because at that time, I didn't want to sound like a sorehead, you know, rapping rock and roll or something. But since it's with us, we must live with it.
Yeah, and it's with us.
So now I can sort of take a little smack at it and people laugh. Even the kids come in. The teenagers came in the other night. Oh, about a whole row of them. They heard that I was doing rock and roll. I surprised them. I wasn't doing it, but the little gags that I was doing in this part, and a couple of spots there, particularly on Mona Lisa, they thought it was sharp.
Well, what's charming about it is...
Well, it's very good-natured, though. It's a real good-natured slab, but I mean, it's not really
And he parodies his own stuff, which is great. Mona Lisa and Nature Boy and all that.
And then he says, Mr. Cole won't rock and roll, and then he walks out and he says, yeah, I want it.
Speaking of jazz, I heard you had a great concert here, which I'm sorry I missed, but I have to. I got a call from somebody from organization in Lima, Peru.
You were in Lima at the time?
I've sat up in the hotel room and I get a phone call. I don't know the fella's name right now that called me in regards to this jazz concert.
Mm.
And he said, I want you to do a concert. I said, are you kidding? I said, I'm in Peru. He said, I know. I said, why don't you just call GAC right there in Chicago? Why are you calling it all the way down here? Hear me say
touch.
No and waste all the money. You can get it right up there. He said, I just wanted to talk to you.
Because he had a credit card. He used it.
Well, as a matter of fact, Ella, who's going to be with us a little later on in the evening.
I thought that was pretty funny, Hugh, and you just brushed me.
I'm sorry.
That's good. I just got
stepping on some of your best material.
It's not sincere. Mm-hmm.
Say, by the way, I got to get that album of yours.
Yeah, it's a groovy album.
Did you really take that cover in the graveyard?
In a cemetery.
You really did. No props.
No, there was really. How it happened was. Is it okay to cop out?
Yeah, you can.
Okay.
Tell the true story.
He's referring to the cover, the cemetery there. Well, what had happened is you can't just sneak in a graveyard and take a picture.
You had the permission?
Well, broad daylight.
Permission?
No one signed any releases there.
Cast of thousands, but
Hollywood is, pretty wild, pretty
you
far
took
out kind
this
of people.
Was taken in Hollywood.
In a Hollywood graveyard.
Which one?
Well,
no commercials.
I can't.
Oh, you can't tell.
No.
Oh, they don't want it advertised.
Well, no, they didn't know about it. The people in the grave.
Yard.
Yard.
Well, I mean the caretaker. What happened is. an eccentric millionaire, a friend of mine, who owns the property. And he really doesn't particularly dig the graveyard. Enjoy it, you know. And he asked me if I wanted to help him break the lease. So we went, ha ha, that's a true.
Is it really true?
There's a lot of real freaks out there, you know. So that was it. So we said, let's go. And but, you know, he didn't want him to be irreverent and jump on the graves or anything like that. Just walk softly, have the picnic, and split. And that was it. You know?
Just a quiet, good taste picnic in the middle.
And
of
all
the
he wanted to do was watch. Mm-hmm. And that was his kick.
This is the album cover of Lenny's.
Yeah.
That's pretty far out. Pretty far out.
It's a pretty far out album, too.
Yeah, I heard a lot about this.
Especially since the A&R man is buried there.
Since?
Since,
yeah.
Oh, they left him there.
They left this cover,
yeah. After the album came out.
Well, these talk albums are becoming a very big thing. Mort Saul's got a couple of them out, and the one by.
Let's see, there's Tom Lee here, was the...
You mean just talking all the way through?
Yes,
Well, no, he does piano song.
The recitation.
Yeah, monologue style, yeah.
Shelley Berman.
He's got the big...
Oh, yes, I heard about it.
He's got the really catching on.
He's got the biggest seller. He really dwarfs any of the other talk albums.
I'm getting ready to make an album, not a talk album, but I'm going to do an album pretty soon, which is a thing where I do recitations prior to the song that I'm going to sing.
Franklin McCormick?
No,
why
not,
do I
not,
love
not
you?
Quite that milky.
Did you ever hear that one?
No, this is
why
a story.
Do I love you?
This is a story. All songs are, you know, joined in to make a big story. And prior to each track, I say something leading into each song. Say about half a minute. Lyrics. No poems. It's talking, just like you tell the story.
So
then you illustrate
the
song. And each song takes this guy through a whirlwind of mad love. And he ends up at the end still way out.
You know what record that you did that sort of lent itself to that story feeling? Haji Baba is a cool record that had that sort of feeling to it with the music that you were telling a story of.
Well, kind of a surprise for us here tonight. We're talking about love, which is what, in part, Rona's book was about. And we managed to get ourselves a little hunk of the film from, and this is a surprise for you, Rona. We got some film from the new picture, and I think we'll get a chance here to show it maybe, and we can talk a little bit about the characters. But before we
you don't remember me, Rona, but I was your school teacher. This is your life, Rona.
That's what it's going to be, Rona.
Oh, my, better than
and,
that.
We'll take a little look at
these
this.
These are some of the reels you did overseas. You're the beholder, right?
Before we turn this one on, we've got another little film segment that that pays the bill. We'll look at that one first, then we'll look at
and then we'll turn
the
on.
Special one.
All right, the film.
We're going to run a brief scene here from The Best of Everything with, Hope Lang and Brian Ahern and Louis Jordan. And Joan Crawford?
Mm-hmm.
And we'll take a look at that now.
Fred Horsey. Fred Horsey.
He's in the
sea. He's in the
sea. Hold it a minute while I go get a drink, would you?
Well, we'll start it, and you can catch it from a corner there, Nat.
You know how to work this and everything.
Eleanor, will you bring the lights down?
Right. You could work it and everything. Send the home.
About your wife.
Well, what about her?
Well, she's gonna be hurt.
How can she be hurt?
She's gonna lose you.
Well, she never had me. Not the way you have me.
No, I mean when you tell her about us. When you ask for a divorce. When you and I get married.
Carolyn, I've worked something out for us. I had a talk with Jim last night.
Jim?
My father-in-law, Helen's father. He's agreed I should open an office here. Closer to the oil companies. I'll have an apartment, too. Every month I'll be here for a few days.
Wait a minute. What has this got to do with us getting married?
Darling, I'm trying to tell you that we can't be married. But I can't lose you either. We can have each other. You'll have your own life, your career, and I'll have mine. Helen won't be hurt. Nobody will be hurt.
Eddie, do you love Helen? Is that what you're trying to say?
No, I love you.
But you don't want to marry me?
I can't.
Why? mind, it doesn't matter. That's the second mistake I've made with you.
Oh, Carolyn, if you let me...
Eddie, tell me something. What is it about women like us that make you hold us so cheaply? Aren't we the special ones from the best homes and the best colleges? I know the world outside isn't full of rainbows and happy endings, but to you, aren't we even decent?
What are you talking about?
I won't be your mistress!
Carolyn, this kind of thing happens all the time.
Oh, not to me, it doesn't. I'm too square for you, Eddie. There are other girls. Oh, there are dozens of girls all over this city just waiting for you. You won't have to do a thing. You may have to take them to a 21 once or twice, or eat a lousy casserole dinner in their walk-up apartment. They all like to play at being wives once in a while. And there'll be some that you'll hurt very badly because they all care too much. But that's their problem, isn't it? Then you'll find those who want just what you want. All love and no responsibility. Honey, hang on to those. Even if it means that they have to take on a few more like you in between visits. But don't blame them. Because they, like the rest of us, they have an impossible need. They want to be loved.
Carolyn.
Goodbye, Eddie.
What's it like, Rona, to see your the characters from your book of fiction, I assume, though it may be partially fact, come to life on the screen?
It's a very strange feeling. I've been waiting for this for about a year since they started to write the script. And, you know, the first time I saw a screening, a rough cut, I was so terrified. It was like, you know, something you dream about, and it's almost like a daydream should never come true, because if it does come true, it's too much of a strain. You can't face it. And there it was, and there were all these people, and they look just exactly like the people in the book. The casting is marvelous.
In other words, you were very happy with the casting.
Yeah.
Well, I've heard it suggested that that Hope Lang's part was kind of drawn from either your experiences in New York, or at least your feelings about them, and that she kind of spoke your feelings about the city. Is that true?
I don't know. I think you always say that the main character is the author. Actually, in this book, with every girl, I put myself in her place when I wrote the book, mm-hmm. and kind of empathized with her. So I think there may be a little of me in all of them.
A lot of authors feel that, except Kinsey. Did you notice, I did, a very bright, you remember I yelled at you, this Brett Halsey in the film?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Beautiful man, a nutty looking face. I really, comes across very handsome, good actor too. There's a lot of bees, you know, I come from the coast. Mm-hmm. And you know what the last picture he was in? The Son of the Fly.
He made some.
He's too much, right?
That's really big. Small world, the fly.
See, Brett Halsey in The Best of Everything, a novel by Rona Jaffe. The story of crisp, bright young women who come out of the office buildings in their crisp, bright dresses. Brett Halsey, who is seen in The Best of Everything, was last in an Academy Award performance as The Fly.
Help me! Help me! I'm over here! Help me!
You wrote it! That's right.
We published it. He didn't write it.
Why did they say such a beautiful boy and put the ugly fly's head on him? They could have had anybody.
We tried to talk him and he wanted it. He likes to be a fly. That's all. He likes to get in the sugar. Did you put, what happened with the fly? I don't want to get off your book.
The fly was originally a story in Playboy. The lead story in our June 15th.
I remember.
Some very unusual
illustration. It had a whole wide page with a little tiny fly in the back.
A little tiny fly. $4,000 color reproduction this size and all
white. It was a groovy, good idea.
It's a crazy story.
Let's get off that and back to the book there.
Ronald, dear, I want to ask you a question which may sound a little rude, but I'm so tired of interview shows where everything is set up to be so nice between author and interviewer, and in other words, a party. I want to ask you this sort of tough question, you know. I'm terribly interested in book publishing business, and when I see this advanced publicity, And then I see a book come out, and I see it climb up to, I think, number 6 on the bestseller list.
5. Yeah.
And then I read the New York Times and the Herald Tribune and the Saturday Review and other so-called egghead review media, and they all say, this is 5 soap operas wrapped up into one, and you don't need to read it.
I'm glad you mentioned the Saturday Review, because that was one of the best reviews I got. It was marvelous.
Who wrote that?
There was one review which was by a woman, and she said...
I see.
She said that it was so true that every girl who reads it is going to have a shock of recognition, and it was a marvelous review, which we in fact used in the ads. Mm-hmm. And go on with your question.
Well, I just wondered how you reacted to the fact that perhaps Saturday Review, to the contrary, notwithstanding,
no, that was really marvelous.
The literary reviewers in general.
Well, the Times.
Didn't think
I don't know how you can say the Times and the Tribune are all the literary reviewers, because before the book came out, I was absolutely terrified that I would get I don't know what, and I said, I'm not going to read any reviews. I've just written this book, and that's all. So for about a month, I didn't read any reviews, and then my editor said to me, look, you're crazy. The reviews are wonderful. Read them. And I did, and the reviews were mostly very good. They were, yeah, because I have a whole collection. I've got about 200 of them.
Fascinating. Do you consider the book literature?
What is your definition of literature?
Well, do you consider it a... let me rephrase it. Do you consider this a hardcover periodical that will have a short life and that's the end, or something that will be being read 5 or 10 or 15 or 50 years from now?
I don't think you can tell until 5 or 10 or 50 years from now. I really don't. I don't think you ever know. I think if you set out to write the great American masterpiece, you will write the great American bore.
Well,
I've never seen
more.
It fail. Mm-hmm. And I think I write the kind of book that I like to read. That's all.
After I have to read it about
10 times, I have to read The Galleys, and so I might as well write something I like. That's all.
What motivated you to write it?
Well, I wanted to write a book. What motivated me to write this particular book or any book?
Well, both. Let's start with, you know, basic motivation. What makes a young attractive girl decide suddenly that she's going to stop working for Fawcett or Gold Medal or wherever you were working?
Gold Fawcett.
and sit down and write herself a book.
And were you working for them at the time that you wrote the book?
No, I quit.
Short time before, or?
Well, I quit because I didn't want to work anymore, and then I thought as long as I was free, I would write a book. You want me to give you a real egghead answer? You won't laugh while
I
really wrote this
book?
I want a real answer. I mean, you can't. How can you sit here, at a party or anywhere, and, in a dress like this and give an egghead answer? But I'll tell you the truth.
Let me tell you something.
You know,
and I know, that it is extremely difficult, extremely lonely, and extremely exacting to write a book.
Yes.
And you lived in New York City, and you were a single girl, and presumably all these predatory wolves were surrounding you, but you preferred to stay home and work. Why?
Well, I'll tell you. This is the first time I've ever said anything this egghead, and I'm waiting for you to laugh, but it's true, and I'll be very brave. I think that the only way that a person, a human being, can get a sense of identity is through doing something, and something which is for somebody else. And I wrote this book, really, for girls like April in the book, who were going to go through this kind of thing in New York, and for girls who had gone through this kind of thing. And the great tragedy is that these girls just think they're the only one. They think that, I'm alone and I can't tell anybody because it's so awful and I have this problem. And it was so that if even one girl would read it and would say, I now realize that somebody knows about my problems and my life. And from doing this, I got a sense of importance, which I had to get
which
from doing
became,
something.
Certainly.
Mm-hmm. But it wasn't to become important. I didn't do it so that I would become a famous writer of a bestseller and become important that way. Because that's another thing. And if you don't become successful for something that you're proud of, it's no good. I mean, at least for me it isn't, because I would just feel like I was going through false pretenses.
Well, if the story comes out with any tinge of the soap opera about it, it is maybe only because or partly because there are so many of these, almost everyone in all of your characters are involved in some kind of extramarital or premarital or some kind of problem relationship. And maybe it's the fact that I don't think there was a girl, at least not in the movie, there wasn't a girl in the picture that had more than four or five lines that didn't have some pretty big problems with
pretty
men.
Pretty perfect problem.
Their problems were all men, and all the men seemed to be...
All I can say is I think life is one big soap opera, and to illustrate it to you, the next time you ever tell a girl you love her, stop and say, how would this look on the printed page? I guarantee you, you'll stop in the middle of the sentence and say, let's have a drink and forget it.
I surrender.
You had a very nice theme song, you know, Best of Everything.
Yeah, you mean in the picture?
In the picture.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I sort of thought Soap Gets in Your Eyes might have
been. I didn't write the song, and I think it's very pretty.
I do too.
Well, the full Johnny Mathis version.
I think it's
going
to be a very successful picture.
Yeah. I'm certain it's going to be.
It should be explained, Rona, that Speck is expressing here a little. Well, we at Playboy have a very. See, we feel that some of the problems of the. Of America at least, are. An over-feminization, and we have a somewhat different notion about the whole thing. And
excuse me, Hef. Ella Fitzgerald just came in.
Ah, wonderful. Excuse me just a minute. Ella is here, and we'll be back with her in just a matter of moments. It's great having you with us, Ella. A real pleasure, as always. And I've got a little surprise for you that I think you're going to get a kick out of. This summer, Playboy threw a jazz festival. It was the biggest, and according to the critics, the best thing of its kind ever put together. And certainly without any question, the high point of the entire weekend for us and everybody there was Ella's performance. Now we've got a little track of that here, and Downbeat called this the very best thing that Ella has ever done. Imagine the very best of Ella, they said, and double it. And you're gonna get a chance to hear that now. Ella's never heard it. We brought it up as a surprise. It's not available commercially, but it's something pretty special. Let's listen to it.
I guess I'd better quit while I'm ahead with way back home in Idaho. that's in my eyes.
Ella, that was really one of the high moments in jazz, and a wonderful moment for all of us, too.
Thank you, Hef.
I wonder, the group is here, and I wonder if you'd sing a song for us.
Well, we can try. Do something for you.
Thank you.
Okay. We do good enough for me. Okay. This is informal, right?
Writing songs of love, but not for me. A lucky star's above, but not for me.
Doing a little swing number like Young. Love, warm and
think, baby, it's like love. Now we're riding a rainbow to Cloudsville, a Wildsville. We're making it like like young, like
you.
Hi.
Ella, will you get out of town for us?
All right, is that a cue?
No cue, just first off.
All right, I'll get out. Get out of town before it's too late, my love. Get out of town. Be good.
You were able to join us this evening. I hope you had as nice a time as we did. Try to be with us again next week. Remember, we'll be here each week, same time, same place. We'll be talking to some interesting people, some interesting personalities, people from show business, and generally having ourselves a good time. Try to be with us again on Penthouse Party. Till then, good night.